Armando Hasuringan, biology and medicine videos. Please make sure to subscribe. Join the forum and group for the latest videos. Please visit Facebook Armando Hasuringan. In this video, we're going to look at Helicobacter pylori, the bacteria known to cause peptic ulcers as well as duodenal ulcers. Helicobacter pylori is a gram-negative rod bacteria. Here I'm drawing sort of simplified structure of the bacteria. H. pylori have flagella, which help in motility, in moving around. It also has DNA, which is circular within it. Some important virulence factors that Helicobacter pylori possesses include lipopolysaccharides, which help in adhering to cells. Another important virulent factor H. pylori have is an enzyme on the surface known as urease. Now, urease is very important in Helicobacter pylori survival. What urease does is that it converts urea and water to carbon dioxide and ammonia. And this is important, and we'll soon see why. But essentially, ammonia, which is NH3, is quite basic, so it's alkaline. And then H. pylori can also secrete some exotoxins, such as VAC-A and CAG-A. VAC-A essentially causes apoptosis of cells. And then CAG-A is responsible for disrupting the cellular integrity and structure, and also promotes inflammation. If that doesn't all make sense, don't worry. Hopefully, we'll be able to understand it after going through this video. So H. pylori is a common cause of peptic ulcers and duodenal ulcers. Let's just have a look at the anatomy of the stomach briefly and the GIT. So here we have the stomach and here we have the duodenum, which is the first part of the small intestine. The pylori sphincter here essentially is a barrier between the stomach and duodenum. Anyway, the stomach has a few parts to it. The fundus, which is the top, the cardia, which is essentially the first part where the esophagus meets the stomach, the body, and then we have the antrum. Now, the antrum is the most important part here because the antrum is where H. pylori typically resides in. And actually, 50% of people have H. pylori living inside them as commensals, you can say, commensal bacteria. So zooming into the antrum, the stomach, we can see that the stomach cells are composed of columnar epithelial cells. And the columnar epithelial cells, they have between them junctions known as tight junctions. Above these columnar epithelial cells, we have a layer of mucus, which are produced by the goblet cells. And mucus is very important because it acts as a barrier from the hydrochloric acid, a layer on top. And the hydrochloric acid is important to it in the digestion of food. The hydrochloric acid is produced by cells known as parietal cells. And of course, above this acidic layer, we have the lumen of the stomach. Residing within the lumen of the stomach, or just on top around here, we have the bacteria H. pylori. And they could be here either through a infection or they could just be there normally, because as I mentioned, about 50% of people have H. pylori within their stomach. So just drawing this up, we can see that the pH decreases from the mucus layer up the top. So the acid layer, the hydrochloric acid layer, is the most acidic. So H. pylori, how does it survive in this acidic environment? You see, in the stomach, you find the chemical urea. And H. pylori can convert urea to carbon dioxide and ammonia. H. pylori can do this because it has the enzyme urease. And urease converts urea and water to carbon dioxide and ammonia. And ammonia is sort of alkaline. So it sort of neutralizes the acidity there. And therefore, the H. pylori is able to move down towards the cells of the stomach. and it can move down with the help of its flagella, which helps in motility. So two things it's doing, it is using its enzyme urease to make ammonia, which neutralizes the acidity, and it's the H. pylori is using the flagella to help it in moving down towards the stomach cells. Once it makes contact with the stomach cells, it can adhere to the stomach cells using a lipopolysaccharide. And once H. pylori adheres to the stomach cells, it can secrete these dangerous exotoxins such as CAG-A and VAC-A. And as I mentioned, CAG-A disrupts cell integrity and essentially breaks down this tight junctions between the stomach cells. At the same time, CAG-A stimulates the production of certain cytokines within these cells, cytokines such as interleukin-8. So what does interleukin-8 do? Well, interleukin-8 is sort of like a chemokine which attracts neutrophils into the area. And neutrophils are highly inflammatory and can damage, essentially, the stomach tissue. So interleukin-8 promotes inflammation. Now we have VAC-A. VAC-A essentially induces or causes apoptosis of the stomach cells. So the combination of CAG-A and VAC-A causes essentially just the breakage of the stomach cells. And this essentially allows the hydrochloric acid layer and mucus layer on top to basically come in. And as the hydrochloric acid layer comes in, it will really damage and eat up the surrounding tissue. And this is how the ulcer is formed. It should be pointed out that the H. pylori infection in the stomach, which will promote inflammation, will actually result in a lot more hydrochloric acid being produced by the parietal cells. And this is because inflammation essentially promotes hydrochloric acid secretion in the stomach due to histamine, for example. And with so much hydrochloric acid being produced by the stomach, the hydrochloric acid can actually enter the duodenum, which is normally basic. And so this H. pylori infection can result in a duodenal ulcer as well. I hope this makes sense. So I hope that made sense. Now, to diagnose a H. pylori ulcer, we use a urea breath test. A urea breath test is essentially when a urea chemical is tagged, the carbon of the urea chemical is tagged, and then the person eats the urea, and then so the urea sample will go down to the stomach where maybe the H. pylori is. If the H. pylori is there, the urea with water will be converted to carbon dioxide and ammonia. And then this carbon dioxide will actually have that chemical tagged on the carbon. The carbon dioxide will then leave the stomach to the bloodstream. The carbon dioxide will travel up to the heart, and then the heart will pump the blood with this chemically tagged carbon dioxide to the lungs, and then the carbon dioxide will be exhaled out. And so the presence of a chemically tagged carbon dioxide will indicate that it is a H. pylori infection. Other ways to diagnose a H. pylori infection include a stool sample test. Now, to treat H. pylori infections, you usually use proton pump inhibitors to sort of prevent hypersecretion of hydrochloric acid, and you also use antibiotics to target the Helicobacter pylori. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching. Bye.